Good morning, everyone. I will spend a few minutes here trying to give you my understanding, let's say our understanding of this topic after months, I would say years of interacting with any kind of companies, no? From startups to big corporates, non-profits, all this conversation led us to this kind of conclusions that I'm sharing with you today. So first of all, just a couple of words on myself. I am a creator of this platform design toolkit. You can easily look it up on the internet. These pictures coming from a masterclass that we held in Paris in March 2017. Actually, the next one is going to be tomorrow here in Paris again. It's completely sold out, so there's no way for you to jump in if you are curious, but we are going to have another one in 1 month and a half, on 21st of March in Amsterdam. What is this kit? Essentially, it's a design toolkit framework, a design thinking framework, to help designers and platform shapers to achieve what I call the evolution from customer-centric design into ecosystem-centric design. And I think my conversation of today is going to more or less explain this perspective. So if I recall, most of the APIs strategies I've been involved in as a consultant in these last few, I would say in the last decade, most of them were basically driven by this monetization input, let's say. No? Everybody was looking for, okay, how do we make money with our infrastructure? How do we make money with our business process? And so on. So everything was about monetizing APIs. Normally, no, this kind of approach led to encapsulating things like components or services that our company was able to provide and put a price tag on it. So it was really about componentization, essentially, you know, putting a wrapper on top of an existing component and putting it on the market. Essentially, this was, for my understanding, was really a race to the bottom, because if you know a little bit of a business strategy and business evolution, you know that componentization is really the last step of the evolution for a service. No, it's really when you start providing value essentially at the essential cost of business. So you don't really make money on components. So that's why I think it's a race to the bottom. There's a concept in business thinking which is called stack fallacy. Essentially, companies normally really underestimate the complexity of innovating, going upwards in the value chain. And everybody thinks that it can go up in this value chain, like a database company thinks that apps, for example, are easy. But then, you know, you discover that it's really hard to go up in the value chain, because normally you know much better what to expect from your suppliers than what your market, your consumers, or your user expect in terms of novelty and innovations. So from my experience, most of the APIs strategies that I've seen in the last few years were mostly about, you know, coming back from our idea that we can innovate for real in terms of business strategy, and we end up just encapsulating our let's say, lower levels of the value chain. And so from what I've seen, it was always about companies, sorry, there's an error here, there, but it was only about companies facing this increasing complexity, like volatility, uncertainty, all the VUCA things that you all know. So basically facing this changing environment every time and you know, trying to find some safe harbor in the idea that we can componentize and make the consumption of our infrastructure a bit less efficient. So if it's clear that, to my understanding, this is not an answer to the big question, so what is the approach that a company or an organization should follow when thinking about their API strategy? So I start from this quote of Esko Gilpi, which I think is really clear in explaining that in an interconnected world, the only way to develop real intelligence is by interacting with others, being them humans, individuals, small companies, other big companies, and so on. So the foundation of the human intelligence is in cooperation. To really understand, let's say, how to move from this solution perspective into the conversation perspective, this is what we need to do. As I said before, we need to move from user-centered or consumer-centered design into what we call ecosystem-centered design. And normally also think that this means essentially focusing on the relationships instead of the individuals. So moving from this isolation concept into the interconnecting context. And from what we understand, this means moving from providing solutions to problems, so basically giving, considering that your company is able to self-define itself in setting a solution and giving to someone for consumption, into invitations and conversations. So the big message here for me, for companies and organizations that can thrive in complexity, it's about understanding that you cannot define your organization in isolation anymore. The only way to define the future of your organization is through conversations, is through interactions with ecosystems. Because it's the ecosystem that is going to help you figure out what you are going to do in 5 or 10 years. So how can we embrace this way of designing our platform strategies or APIs strategies? I think we can borrow a lot from the ideas that are related to play and games in general. And that's also a bit of our framework. It's inspired by Jean de la, sorry, I cannot speak French, but Jean de la Roche-Brochard, which is a French-speaking writer that once shared this very interesting framework, and we have tried to embed this framework into our thinking. And essentially, what you need to create, first of all, is a vision, it's a narrative, it's a story that you can share with a larger ecosystem. So not just with your company, with your employees, with everything which is around it. And this narrative is normally made of language, the language you use, the vision, the rules that you set. To empower this narrative, normally you need to provide two kinds of things. One is what we call the primitives. So basically, the channels, the means for the ecosystem to self-organize. The idea of post-industrial companies is that you need to stop thinking that you can organize value for everyone. You need to just enable them to self-organize, to create services and products, to exchange services and products through channels. So the first thing you need to stop doing is stop thinking about products and solutions and start thinking about context, and start thinking about channels that you can create to enable this interaction. Of course, on the other hand, to support this capability to self-organize, to improve quality, to generate better performances, you need to think of the services you can provide as an enabler in terms of learning, improvement, how you can support a continuous performance evolution in the ecosystem, how you can help them thrive and evolve in a super complex and volatile environment as everybody is feeling now. So basically, if some of you is familiar with the idea of user innovation toolkits, this has been a landmark in the product design culture, let's say, for decades. It's like we are trying to create ecosystem innovation toolkits. So that's where this concept of disobedience is coming from. So you don't create a system that is finished. You still want to create a system that leaves the possibility to the ecosystem to be disobedient, to invent new things. And normally, when it comes to APIs, and one big point I want to make today is that you cannot think of your API strategy in isolation. It's not about the APIs. It's about the value you want to enable. And so when you look at APIs, I think you can, I cannot project, but essentially you won't think of what integrated experience first you want to provide to your ecosystem, being your consumers or your producers, not just the consumer of your solutions. And on top of that, you want to leave them to be disobedient, to use your services and your APIs maybe to just try to invent new things. Then you need to keep an eye on what they do. And within time, and that's another big point, your API strategy is going to be evolutive. It cannot be designed once and then be the same for the next 5 years. you need to keep an eye on what they are trying to achieve with your infrastructure, with your platforms, and within time you want to encapsulate this in more curated experiences. Well, on top of them, you still need to give the ecosystem the possibility to be disobedient again, because once they invent something new and you encapsulate in your offering, then they need to explore the value chain and be, let's say, go upwards and invent new things. So within time, you can componentize for real part of your offering, part of your services, and that's where APIs come handy. But yeah, the big picture is that this process needs to bring you an understanding of what your ecosystem is trying to achieve. Where is the value for your ecosystem? What is the value for the larger ecosystems of organizations interacting with individuals? So basically here, you can see that there are three things. It's not just about componentization, because if you start by the components, you really see just a small part of the picture. It's not just about componentization, it's about what you leverage, so what you encapsulate in excellent experiences, and it's about what, where the innovation comes from, which is outside from your organization. In general, it's about your ecosystem, it's not about you to be innovative. So this picture gives you a full understanding of what does it mean to create innovative experiences, platforms, and APIs. It's three factors, not just components. So having said that, I think the point here is understanding that we need to stop thinking of organizations as a noun and start talking about organizing as a verb. So it's really about organizing, and not just organizing your employees and your resources, but organizing how for the interconnected value creation that happens in larger ecosystems, not just for your company. So basically, what I'm suggesting you to do is, to, if you really want to thrive in complexity, is start thinking about design for interconnectedness. So deliberately design your products, your services, your strategies, your APIs, your platforms to nurture relationships, to nurture the ecosystem as a whole. Because, you know, everybody knows the Maslow pyramid, and everybody knows that on top of the value chain, you have this idea of self-actualization. And I think we are really understanding now that it's no more about the actualization of an individual, but it's about the actualization of an ecosystem as a whole. So it's really about designing for interconnectedness, designing for relationships. Of course, for your company, it's not going to be easy. And as Francesca said before, we really think that organization needs to be thought differently. And there is this Conway law that everybody knows in the world of APIs, probably, that at the end of the 60s already said, basically, if you want to create something for complexity, your organization cannot be a set of silos. So you will really feel strong challenges to your organizational culture to really start thinking for and thriving in complexity. So as Francesca said before, we are praising a different concept of organizations and companies. We are praising an idea that the company needs to stop thinking in terms of boundaries, like my employees, my resources, my profits, my whatever. And you really need to start thinking in terms of boundaryless organizing. As I said a few weeks ago, everybody can work for you today if you create the right incentives for doing it. And this is something that most of the world-changing companies have already understood, as you know. All these huge platforms that are completely reshaping industries, they do that through powerful incentives. And new technologies, like, for example, the blockchain that everybody is talking about, will really give you a new possibility in terms of incentive design. We are seeing a very strong convergence and potentially game-changing convergence between design services and products and designing economic spaces, designing monetary policies. It's really huge. It's going to give you a whole new set of incentives for developers, investors, not just for users and producers. So everything is going to change. You need to embrace complexity. And you know, I want to stop this presentation and be faster so we can have a few minutes maybe to have a chat. quoting Nora Bateson, which is, I think, really good at giving you this understanding. So basically, you want to stop thinking as a rational entity. You want to stop thinking in terms of industrial policies. You need to start asking questions. You need to start nurture conversations. You need to start thinking about how interconnected can your company be and how to improve this connectivity and this interconnectivity. So you need to understand that, as Nora says, the larger ecological situation will always draw on your attention to control it, not to define it in a rational way. That's everything for me today. Thanks for your time and attention. I'm happy to have a chat.
Hello. Thank you for sharing this framework with us. I wondered if you could speak more about, in your view, of what you hope will be achieved from allowing for more disobedience. What does disobedience mean to you?
Well, I can make two remarks. One is very practical, and for example, I always use this example of Airbnb, which is a very strong leader of the interconnected economy and the network economy. And if you look at Airbnb evolution within time, it's always been about creating a platform, creating some experiences, look at what the ecosystem was doing on top of what was possible, so at the edge of the experience that was available, like, for example, introducing experiences on top of hosting people at their own rooms. And then, within time, Airbnb has been encapsulating this into the whole, into the flagship experience. So this is what I mean, listening to the disobedience. Another example could be Amazon, with the Amazon AWS. For example, they have been looking at what people have been trying to achieve in terms of using their infrastructure to create data analytics services. And within time, they created increasingly encapsulated and packetized offerings, instead of leaving this possibility to the ecosystem. So it's about continuously kind of commoditizing what the ecosystem is doing to push the ecosystem to be more innovative, to invent new things. It's a very strong and nurtured relationship you need to have with your ecosystem, because within time you are going to eat part of their cake, let's say, to push them to invent new cakes. That's the idea. But on the other hand, I think this idea of disobedience in general and conversations is because I'm really reluctant to say that companies can find solutions for these global problems, and in general that anyone can find solutions for the global problems we are living. So I think our only opportunity is to really start to have an interaction and see what we are going to come up in the next years from this interaction. So I'm reluctant to go along this idea that we can create solutions, and more about let's see what happens all together, in interconnectedness. That's more or less an answer.
Can you give us an example of a customer, for example, who attended your workshops and what they got, improvements, whatever? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I mean, I cannot speak of practical cases, but We have been working with I don't want to make a spot, but really we have been working with any kind of companies. No, so the whole idea, I think the most important insight that I want to share, and they normally the attendees to our masterclass and the user of our toolkits, which is open source, so we have thousands of users that don't even talk with us and use our frameworks. I think that the biggest insight is that you need to stop. You need to stop thinking that you can create a platform and push it on the ecosystem. But it's much more about understanding what your ecosystem are trying to achieve and try to resonate with that. So it's like if you're familiar with customer development, for example, and we have been taught that we don't want to create solutions for problems that doesn't exist, that don't exist. So similarly, with platforms, APIs, you need to create an infrastructure, a platform, a strategy, a context for an ecosystem that exists, You cannot create APIs for an ecosystem that doesn't exist. Nobody will use these APIs. You cannot push APIs to the market. You need to pull the ecosystem to use your context. So you need to understand very well what they're trying to achieve before even generating your strategy. Similarly to the relationship between solutions and problems, you need to start from the ecosystem and then think of your platforms and strategies. That's more or less a shared insight.
Thank you so much, Simone.
Thank you for your time.